force called the strong force, which is the force that keeps these quarks bound together inside the protons and neutrons. And we also found that there's a weak force, which is very weak compared to the other forces, but it is responsible for things that happen in the sun, for example. And these forces, with the exception of gravity, are mediated by particles we called force carriers, which are on the here. They're gluons, ZW bosons, and photons. And this gave us the picture of the Standard Model as we know it today. So it consists of six different types of quarks, six different types of leptons, the force carriers, as well as the Higgs boson, which was discovered in 2012. Now, by far, the most mysterious part of the Standard Model is these particles down here that we call neutrinos. In the Standard Model, they don't have any mass. They're completely massless. And they interact via the weak force, so via these Z and W bosons. Now, where can we find neutrinos? I already mentioned them. They come from the sun. We can see them from cosmic rays. When protons hit the atmosphere and subsequently decay, we get a lot of neutrinos. In nuclear power plants, when nuclear break apart, we also have a lot of neutrinos, as well as remnants of the Big Bang. There's about 100 trillion neutrinos that pass through your body every second, but we can't detect them because they interact very, very weakly. And just to give you an idea how weakly, if you have a neutrino that's about 3 MeV, it needs 53 light years before it interacts with water, for example. If you have an electron of the same energy, it will only travel 3 centimeters before interacting. There's a big difference. And this means, because it's so difficult to detect neutrinos, that we need either very, very large detectors to see them or a lot of neutrinos. So with this in mind, we have the Standard Model of particle physics, and it helps us explain the history of the universe. So after the Big Bang, all of these Standard Model particles were free floating. And as the universe began to cool, these particles started to come together. So the quarks started to come in protons and neutrons. And then the protons and neutrons started to gather together in the nucleus of atoms. And then electrons started to encircle these to make full atoms. The atoms then made stars and so on. And the neutrinos are still, and the photons are still floating around in space today. So now I'll tell you a little bit about why the neutrino is the most mysterious particle and about its history. So I'll start with a quote here from Wolfgang Pauli, who said, "I have done a terrible thing. I have postulated a particle that cannot be detected." So what does this mean? How did Pauli know that the neutrino existed? Well, in 1930, he was observing the process of beta decay, which is basically when a neutron converts into a proton and releases an electron. And what he noticed is that the energy carried away by this electron varies. It's not always the same energy. And this led Pauli to speculate that there's particles that we can detect that carry away the additional energy. And that's why the electron energy varies. And he titled this particle the neutrino. However, it wasn't until 1956 that we actually discovered the neutrino. And what we basically did was we put a 1-ton tub of water beside a nuclear reactor. And nuclear reactors, they have these, they produce these types of neutrinos called electron antineutrinos. And they basically interacted with this water, and we detected them. And they interacted via this process. So the neutrino interacted with a proton inside the nucleus to produce a neutron and an electron antiparticle, which is the positron. And the way we detected them is that this positron combined with the electron, and it created a flash of light. And this flash of light was detected by photomultipliers that surrounded this tub of water. And the second signal was, because the water was spiked with cadmium, this neutron was absorbed by the cadmium and it created another flash of light, also detected by these photomultipliers. So we saw two flashes of light, and that was our signal that neutrinos do really exist. And for this work, the Nobel Prize was obtained in 1955. So with this in mind, we knew that neutrinos come from the sun. We knew that there had to be a solar model of particle physics, so describing the neutrino fluxes from the sun. And this was the prediction. So this was the fluxes of neutrinos coming from the sun as a function of the neutrino energies. So we had different types of colors for different type of interactions within the sun that provided different neutrino fluxes. And there's an experiment called the Homestake experiment in the South Dakota mine that basically used a giant tub of dry cleaning fluid to detect the first electron neutrinos from the sun. Now, this only detected 1/3 of the flux that was initially predicted of solar neutrinos. Nonetheless, it received the Nobel Prize in 2002. So there was a mystery. We predicted a certain amount of neutrinos. We were only detecting 1/3 of them coming from the sun. Why? So in 2001, SNOW was another heavy water tank, about 1 kiloton in Canada. And it measured the spectrum of these boron 8 neutrinos. They're called boron 8 because it's a process where boron decays to beryllium, and in that process produces neutrinos. Now, SNOW not only detected this electron neutrino from the sun, but it was also able to detect the total flux of the different types of neutrinos. So the muon neutrino and the tau neutrino as well. And it, what found out was that the total flux was consistent with the standard model, but still only 1/3 of neutrinos were electron neutrinos, which tells us we got the total flux right, right? But only 1/3 of them were coming to us on Earth. Now, could it be that the total flux of neutrinos that originally left the sun was correct, but as they were traveling to us, they were changed from an electron neutrino to different types of neutrinos, primarily the tau and muon neutrino? And this is exactly what happened. So fortunately, there was an old theory that we could dust off and use, made by Pontecarvo, Mackey, and Makagawa Sakata. And it was described as a PMNS matrix that basically describes how these different flavor of neutrino oscillations changed as they traveled from the sun towards us. Now, this is very good news for explaining the experimental observations, but it's bad news for the standard model, because as I mentioned, in the standard model, neutrinos are completely massless. This work also received the Nobel Prize, by the way, in 2015. The Nobel Prize was shared with another experiment that detected a similar phenomenon. This experiment was in Japan, and it wasn't looking at solar neutrinos, but it was looking at neutrinos from the atmosphere. So what happens in the atmosphere is when protons hit the atmosphere, they decay into particles called pions. And these pions then decay into muons and muon neutrinos. So we get a lot of muon neutrinos here on Earth. And this experiment was based in Japan, and it measured these muon neutrinos coming from the sky, as well as traveling from the bottom through the Earth. And it found that it didn't get the same flux of neutrinos from the sky and through the Earth. And this was because the neutrinos that went through the Earth traveled a longer distance. Thus, they had decayed into a different type of neutrino by the time they arrived at the detector. This was more evidence of neutrino oscillations. And again, the experiment had a Nobel Prize in 2015. This is the inside of that experiment. It's again, another giant tub of water, basically, with another photomultiplier. So our liquids inside our tubs change and our photomultipliers get fancier, but it's essentially the same detection mechanisms from which we first detected the neutrinos. So we said the neutrinos oscillate, and the way that they oscillate is this via this PMNS mechanism. And what does that mean? It means that neutrinos have mass eigenstates and neutrino and flavor eigenstates. So the mass eigenstates we call nu 1, 2, and 3. And the mass eigenstates consists of all three different type of neutrino flavors. So the lowest eigenstate is mostly the electron neutrino. The second one is mostly the muon neutrino. And the third one is mostly the tau neutrino. And these flavors change into the mass eigenstates via this PMNS matrix. The PMNS matrix has different components, which I'll describe in a second, but roughly this is what it means. So this is sort of a sinusoidal wave that shows the probability of an electron neutrino changing to a muon neutrino. And you can see, then this is as a function of distance. You can see that as it's traveling, if it travels about 400 kilometers, it will almost certainly turn into a muon neutrino. And then if it travels another 800 kilometers, it will change back into an electron neutrino. So the neutrinos oscillate their flavors as they travel. Now, let me tell you a little bit more about this matrix and this PMNS mechanism and why it's important. There's three different components. The first components of the PMNS matrix is described in terms of these theta angles. Like I said, it's a sinusoidal wave, so it depends on this theta angle. And this component we get from measuring the flux of neutrinos that come from the sun. So this is primarily electron neutrinos that change to muon neutrinos. So we have this angle that I mentioned because it's a sinusoidal wave. We have what we call the mass splitting, which is the difference in masses between this mass eigenstate and this eigenstate. We have the length that the neutrino travels, which is the distance from the sun. And we have the energy of the neutrino. So the length we know is the distance from the sun. The energy of the neutrino we measure in our detectors. The flux of the neutrino we measure. And then we can calculate what is known as the mass splitting and the angle, the coupling angle. So the mass splitting for solar neutrinos we found to be very small. It's 8 × 10⁻⁵ eV. And we do the same thing for other components of the PM&S matrix. So this part of the PM&S matrix mostly deals with atmospheric neutrinos. So again, we have the distance, which is the distance that the neutrinos travel from the atmosphere, the energy, and in most, this part of the matrix mostly describes muon neutrinos going to tau neutrinos. It describes the mass splitting between the third and second neutrinos, so these two up here. And we found this mass splitting to be 2.4 × 10⁻³ eV. So this is a big mass splitting between these mass eigenstates, and this is a very small mass splitting between these mass eigenstates. And the final component of the PM&S matrix is this one that we can extract from reactor and accelerators. So reactors, I already mentioned, we place detectors beside the neutrinos, accelerator neutrino experiments are similar. We have a neutrino accelerator, and we place detectors beside the accelerators. And the advantage of reactor and accelerator experiments is we can vary this length. So we can have the detector as far away from the neutrino source as we want. And again, we measure this mass splitting, and it's found to be 2.4 × 10⁻³ eV. The full theory is a little bit more complicated. I'll just flash the mathematical equations, but I've essentially showed you the gist of it. And that's it for the math part of the presentation. So that's really nice. We're able to explain our experimental observations with an old theory that we already had. But as Albert Einstein said, the more I learn, the more I realize how much I don't know. So what don't we know? Well, we don't know how neutrinos fit into the standard model. Like I said, the standard model thinks they're massless, but the fact that they oscillate means that they must have some mass. We don't know what is the neutrino mass hierarchy or the CP violation, and I'll explain what that means in a second. There's several modern neutrino mysteries which puzzle us, and I'll explain what those mean in a second. We don't know what supernova neutrinos can tell about astrophysical events in the universe. We also don't know what solar neutrinos can teach us about the standard model, and this we would like to find out. And we don't know the origins of dark matter. So actually the standard model describes only 4% of the universe. That includes stars, galaxies, everything that we know of is 4% of the universe. The other 24% is dark matter. The other 74% is dark energy, and we have no idea what that stuff is. So the first thing that we're out on the hunt for is the mass hierarchy. What does the mass hierarchy mean? Well, I said that there's these two mass splittings between the eigenstates. There's this solar one and this atmospheric one. But we don't know if the solar one is at the bottom or at the top. And it's important to figure out which picture that we're looking at here in order to discover the fundamental symmetries that give neutrinos mass. Another thing that we don't know, remember I said that the PM&S matrix has several components. One thing I didn't talk about is this delta phase. So these S's and C's are the sines and cosines of the angles that I mentioned, but this delta is what's called the CP violating phase. It tells us whether neutrinos violate CP symmetry, which basically means whether neutrinos and their antiparticles oscillate with the same probabilities. We want to find this out. This is important because this could potentially help us explain why there's so much matter in the universe. Because when we look out in the universe, there's only matter. We don't see any antimatter. And at the time of the Big Bang, we think that matter and antimatter should have been created in equal amounts. So we want to know, where did all the missing antimatter go? There's also modern neutrino mysteries, meaning there's several different types of experimental results that we just can't explain. So the first one is by Minnie Boone and LSD. And there's basically a neutrino accelerator that was at Fermilab. And beside it was, a big tub of oil surrounded by photomultipliers. It measured muon neutrinos going to electron neutrinos. And you can see the Monte Carlo predictions are in the different colors, and the data is overlaid by these points. And you can see the data overshoots the Monte Carlo. And this is about a 6 sigma effect, which we can't explain. Another one is called the gallium anomaly. So there's a radioactive source, and we place a detector beside it. And then we measure the ratio of the expected to the calculated neutrino flux. And two different collaborations did this, called Galax and Sage. So if the expected and calculated fluxes match, you expect a ratio of one. But in the latest measurements, you can see that they don't. And that's, again, a three sigma effect. And the last anomaly is what we call the reactor anomalies. So these are many. So there's many different nuclear reactors. We've placed detectors beside them at many different distances. And again, we measured the ratio of the expected to the measured flux, which we expect to be one, as a function of how far the detector is from the reactor. So each of these data points is a different reactor and different experiment. And you can see they're all below one. So one is here, and they're all below one. And this is also a three sigma effect. And these could all of these results could possibly tell us that there's a fourth type of neutrino that we don't yet know about, called a sterile neutrino, that we haven't yet detected. Sorry, I don't know if I'm not changing. Okay, so how do we get at uncovering all these different type of neutrino mysteries? How do we get the data? So as William Deming, I think, said, in God we trust, all others must bring data. So we need to find some data in order to uncover some of the mysteries that I discovered. So the data is going to be collected by the Dune collaboration. And just to give you an idea of how big the effort is, it consists of more than 14,000 collaborators, including Turkey, from over 200 institutions in over 30 countries, plus CERN. And what is Dune? Well, the plan is, at Fermilab, we're going to have a neutrino accelerator. It's going to make a very wide energy beam of muon, neutrinos, and antineutrinos. And these neutrinos are first going to pass through a near detector, which is going to characterize the intensity of the beam. And then they're going to travel 1,300 kilometers underground to the far detector, which is located in South Dakota. So we're back at the same facility that previously detected neutrinos. And this far detector is going to be massive. It's going to be four modules. Each of them is going to be 17 kilotons. And it's going to measure various neutrino properties that's going to help us answer all these questions that I already mentioned. So the first question you might have is, how do we make a neutrino beam? So the process is very similar to how, you know, we make neutrinos in the atmosphere. So in the atmosphere, when protons hit the atmosphere, they decay to pions or kaons, and then those decay to muons and muon neutrinos. And that's what we're doing in the lab essentially as well. So we smash protons into a target. Then we have pions and muons, which we focus with a magnet. Then we have what we call a decay pipe. So the pions and kaons just are allowed to travel and decay to muons and muon neutrinos. And then we have a shielding that just stops the muons, and the muon neutrinos pass through it and continue to travel to the near detector and the far detector. The second question you might have is, what will the near detector look like, and what is its function? And to answer that, it's going to be made of three different components, basically. So we're going to have a near detector, which is the first component is what we call the liquid argon time projection chamber, and I'll explain what that means in subsequent slides. It's going to be 50 tons of fiducial mass. It's going to be very similar to the far detector. And its purpose is going to be to characterize the beam, basically, to know what the energy and intensity is. Because by knowing that, we're going to be able to understand our measurements in the far detector. We'll have a gaseous near detector component as well. And it's going to be surrounded by an electromagnetic calorimeter and a muon system. And this is, again, going to have very good tracking resolutions to help us study the interactions between the argon and the neutrinos. And we have what's called SAN, which is a system for on-axis neutrino detection. What that means is the three detector components that I mentioned are here. And SAND means that two of these detector components are going to move back and forth. And what's the point of that? If the neutrinos are coming from here, okay, by moving these detectors, we're going to be able to measure this neutrino beam at different angles, which means effectively we'll be able to characterize the neutrino beam at different energies. So you can see here, if it's measured on axis, meaning if the detector is here, we'll have a wide energy spectrum of neutrino energy that we can measure. If we move the detector out here, we're going to have narrow energy spectrum. And measuring the neutrino flux across different energies will allow us to better characterize the beam. This is called the PRISM system. SAND is an inner tracker and an electromagnetic calorimeter. that also serves as a beam monitor. So that's the last component here. And the prism system is what allows you to move things back and forth. Okay, so that's the near detector. Now let's get to the far detector, which is the thing in the South Dakota mine. So this is 1.2, this is going to be installed 1.2 kilometers underground. We have just basically four big tubs of liquid argon here. And you can imagine neutrinos are coming underground from this direction. So this is going to be installed in two phases. So the first phase, we're going to install these two modules up here. One is going to be what's called a single phase horizontal drift, LAR time projection chamber. And I'll explain what that means in a second. And the other one is going to be a vertical drift. I'll explain what that means as well. The near detector, we're going to have this liquid argon and sand component installed. And the power of the beam is going to be 1.2 megawatts. And then after this initial phase of running, we're going to install these last two modules together with the gaseous near detector and upgrade the beam to 2.4 megawatts. So the excavation for this project has already started. So let me describe a little bit in details how each of these modules work. So if we zoom in each of these modules, we have four different, what we call drift regions. So these are basically, if we zoom into what one of them looks like, we have a cathode plate on this side. We have three different types of anode wires oriented at different angles to each other on this side. And as a neutrino comes through in the liquid argon, it interacts and ionizes the liquid argon. The freed electrons are then going to travel through these to these wires, and you're going to be able to reconstruct a 2D image from the wires. Now, as the neutrinos interact in the liquid argon is a very good scintillator, so you're going to have a lot of light released as well. So this light, which is carried by photons, is going to also be detected in the light photon detection system. And the purpose of detecting the light is that light travels instantaneously. So we're going to right away know when the interaction happened. Whereas these electrons take some time to drift to the wires. So it might take a little bit more time. So this drift region is going to be about 3.5 meters. And that's important because I'll contrast it to the design of the second module later. So zooming in again on one of these planes, so you can basically see you're going to have bars like this. And in between these bars, we're going to have photon detection bars. And if we zoom in to the top of one of these, we call one of these an anode plane assembly. If we zoom in, you can see in the different colors, in the green, purple, and blue, are the wires that I mentioned that are going to be oriented at different angles to each other. And these are going to be read out by front end boards located up here at the top. So these front end boards are going to take the electron signals read out from these wires, and they're going to shape and digitize the signal. And then they're going to send it to these T-shaped structures that are going to be located outside of the cryostat. And these T-shaped structures are going to have more electronics, which we call warm readout boards. And then these warm readout boards will take the data out to the data acquisition system. So each of these parts of the detectors has already been prototyped. So you can see, and we have a big prototype, and you can see sort of a cavity picture of it here. If you zoom into one of these sides, this is what an anode plane assembly looks like. So you can see the copper here is all the different wires oriented at different angles to each other. The green is going to be the readout boards that's reading out the wires. And you can see a zoom in of one of the readout boards here. And then these readout boards are going to take data outside of the cryostat in these T-shaped structures that I mentioned that house these warm interface boards. And again, these are going to take the data to these DAC racks that you can see here. The data acquisition system, has to be very high performance. We have input data of 1.5 terabytes per second, and we can only store 30 petabytes per year. And the idea is from the detector, we're going to have these readout boards, which are going to have FPGAs on them, and then they're going to take the data onto commercial network cards, basically. Now, one particular challenge of the data acquisition system is when supernova events happen in the universe, we're going to have a lot of events over several seconds, and the data acquisition system is going to have to store all of those. So I said everything's been prototyped. This is a facility at CERN, which we call the neutrino platform. All of these prototypes exist in this giant detector. It's the size of a building with different supporting infrastructure. So this detector ran from 2018 to 2020 and it showed excellent performance. It had, you know, over 99.7 of the electronics up. It had very good high voltage stability. And this is one example of an event. So this is an electron neutrino that interacts with the liquid argon and creates these showers. You can see all the little details means that the resolution of the detector is very good. The second design for the second module is going to be a little bit different. It's going to be what we call the vertical drift. So instead of electrons traveling horizontally, they're going to travel vertically. So we're going to have the cathode in the middle and the charge readout plates at the top and bottom. And the advantage to this design is instead of a 3.5 meter drift, we can have a 6.5 meter drift. So a much longer drift time, which means that we're going to need less components. So it's going to be simpler and cheaper to build. So let me quickly tell you about the different components. So at the top, as I said, we have the what we call a charge readout plate. So this part is going to read out all the data. It's a little bit different from the wires that I mentioned. It's going to be basically a double-sided perforated PCB. And these double-sided PCBs are then going to send data in these long tubes, which we call signal readout chimneys. Now, one side of the tube is in the cryostat at very cold temperatures, and the top side is outside at very warm temperatures, which means that this tube is filled with nitrogen gas and sealed in ultra high vacuum flanges to be able to keep these two different temperatures. So the signals from the bottom, so that's how the signals from the top are going to be read out. The signals from the bottom are going to be read out using the same mechanism I described earlier. So then afterwards from this tube, the signals go from what we call basically to the readout crates. We have these AMC cards, which are basically going to digitalize and amplify the signal. Then the signal is going to go to a network switch and then the data acquisition system, which I already described. So you can see that the second module has a bit of a different design. For the second module, we've again prototyped everything. So this is the vertical drift chamber again. We prototyped these feed-out chimneys as well. So this is what the top part is going to look like with these warm signal feed-throughs. This is what the bottom part is going to look like with these cold analog acquisition cards. And then the data send again to these AMC cards, which are in these what we call micro TCA crates and in the DAC system. And all of this is also going to run again this year in this big protodune setup at CERN that I've mentioned. And we expect very good performance as well. So then the last thing I wanted to talk about is once we have built this detector, what can the data tell us? So one of the things I said is that one of the important things to measure is the mass ordering and the CP violation. So this is the dune sensitivity of the mass to the mass ordering and the CP violation. So this is the sensitivity as a function of how many years dune will run. You can see that only about, if you look at this green line, after about 2 years of running, we will have a 5 sigma sensitivity to the mass ordering. And this is for regardless of what the CP violating phase is. If the CP violating phase is simple values like pi over 2, we'll have that even sooner. That's the pink curve. And then for the CP violating phase sensitivity, you can see the sensitivity as a function of the years running. So how long we need to detect with the CP violating phase depends on what the CP violating phase is. So if it's a simple value like negative pi over 2, we'll only need about 3 years. That's the pink line. If it's for about half of the CP values, we'll need about 6 years. And then for 75% of the CP values, it will need about 14 years. So anywhere from 2 to 14 years, this measurement will take depending on what the value actually is. We'll also be sensitive to solar neutrinos. So I said the standard model predicts what kind of neutrino fluxes we should see from the sun. So these are the boron 8 neutrinos that I already mentioned. These are HEP neutrinos, which happen via slightly different nuclear interactions in the sun. And this is the boron 8 spectrum, which we'll expect to see in dune in the blue and HEP in the orange. So for the boron 8 case, you can see this is the efficiency of detection as a function of the neutrino energy. We get almost 100% detection if we're only looking at our our time projection chamber. If we add the light from the information from the light system, the efficiency drops a bit, but we'll be able to measure a lot of these neutrinos. And you might ask yourself, why do we care about measuring solar neutrinos? Well, there's lots of different types of physics we can do. It can not only help verify the standard solar model, it can help us measure the core temperature of the sun, for example. It can characterize the neutrino floor. And this is what this means is basically dark matter experiments. They're soon going to approach a phase which their background is going to be neutrinos. So we need to understand neutrinos really well if we're going to be able to measure dark matter. And these kind of measurements can help us understand them. And then they can also resolve several tensions in experimental measurements. Again, we're going to be sensitive to not just solar neutrinos, but neutrinos that come from the atmosphere and from supernova events. So, core collapses are expected to occur maybe 2 to 3 times per century at a distance of from 10 to 15 kiloparsecs. And when a supernova explodes, you're going to have a massive amount of low energy neutrinos sent over the time period of a few seconds. So we're going to be able to detect all of these neutrinos. And we're going to be able to test astrophysical theories to help astrophysicists, as well as possibly probe new physics. And DUNE is uniquely sensitive to the electron neutrino coming from supernova events, whereas all other experiments are sensitive to the antiparticle of this. So. And okay, this is just an example of the detection of supernova events. If neutrinos didn't oscillate, the blue signal is what this flux would look like for a normal ordering. It would look like the red curve for an inverted ordering. It would look like the green curve. So we'll be able to use these atmospheric neutrinos. I didn't add any plots, but again, we can measure them and test whether our standard model is correct and measure beyond standard model physics. So I've also shown you several modern neutrino mysteries, which we can't explain. A potential explanation, as I mentioned, is the existence of an extra neutrino, which we call a sterile neutrino. And DUNE is going to be sensitive to this. So this is the mass splitting between this extra neutrino and our standard model neutrinos as a function of the coupling between this extra neutrino and our standard model neutrino. So you can see the DUNE sensitivity is in the black here. So everything right of this curve will be excluded. And you can see the DUNE sensitivity is very good, especially when you compare it to other experiments that are shown by all these other type of lines. We'll also be able to potentially detect dark matter. So you can imagine a scenario where the dark matter interacts via this exotic particle with the electrons. And then this is the coupling of the dark matter as a function of the dark matter mass. So you can see that DUNE is going to be able to exclude the parameter space represented by these red lines here, which is quite competitive with existing dark matter experiments, which is shown by the green here, or by the gray. And there'll be other types of beyond standard model physics that DUNE is going to be sensitive to. So I won't go over all of them, but I'll just mention a few of things. So neutrino tridents, basically any type of neutrino self-interactions. And these can explain other experimental anomalies, which I haven't gone into, but if you're curious, you can ask. These include G-2 and B anomalies, which we see in high energy physics. It's going to be able to detect a whole other kind of array of other physics like heavy leptons, non-PM&S unitary proton decay baryon number, and tau neutrino appearance. So tau neutrinos are by far the most mysterious standard model particle. We've only ever detected 12 of them. And DUNE is probably going to give us the biggest sample of tau neutrinos. So that concludes the talk. So, a quick summary is that DUNE is going to be a broadband energy neutrino experiment. We've already created prototypes at CERN. They have run smoothly and they've performed very well. And we plan to run again with the vertical drift towards the end of this year. DUNE will have unprecedented sensitivity to neutrino mass hierarchy. It will have good sensitivity to the CP violation. It will be able to search for extra neutrinos. And it will have a rich atmospheric and solar neutrino program that is under development. We've completed our technical design reports, which I've put number references for here. The FAR detector construction is underway, as is the near detector site construction. And the FAR detector is expected to take physics in late 2020s and with a neutrino beam expected on a similar timescale. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Nicolina. So we have time, and thanks also for staying in time to allow for discussions and questions, if any. May I ask if there are any at Zoom first, and my friends can help? Shall there be any requests? Maybe in the chat? No? Okay. So in the room? There's one.
Hello. The LSND and Miniboon combined results, six sigma. Is that the combined six sigma or separately six sigma each? LSND, I remember, was earlier and higher.
It's combined, but it's not, it's a very rough, it's like a back of the envelope combination. It's not an official combined result. It's like one is three something sigma, the other is three semi sigma. If you're looking roughly at it, it's not a real combination. And also I should mention, Microboon, which succeeded LSND, didn't see these excesses. So it's an additional mystery. So
yeah,
six sigma was a caveat.
What I was getting at, because having the standard solar model giving us the correct, well, at least the measured number of total neutrinos, and then some experiments in US claiming sterile neutrinos always bugged me. If there were a sterile neutrino, then standard solar model should have had something to say about it.
Yeah, no, it's true. So I mean, not only these are mysteries, but these mysteries are refuted by other experiments.
You know, it could be an experimental mystery.
No, of course. So I haven't included the slides, but so there's neutrino appearance and neutrino disappearance measurements. So these particular measurements support the idea of a sterile neutrino, but equivalent measurements, which look for the survival probability of the muon neutrino, go against this measurement or in line with it. So when theorists do these plots, what they see is, is there's a certain area of phase space that is preferred by these anomalies, but this is excluded by another set of experiments. Nice. So now when they do these plots, you know, it's preferred and excluded when you only look at one additional extra neutrino. If you look at a bunch of additional set of neutrinos, these tensions are loosened a little bit. But of course, the results come with a bunch of caveats. I mean, there's experiments that refute the results. It's not a formal combination. But as you know, in standard model of particle physics, we don't have a lot of deviations to go off of. So we got to grab at what we can get.
Okay. Now, something experimental. You said the near detector is moving to trigger on wide or narrow energy. How long is that motion?
It's not moving.
Oh.
It's not moving, you know, as we're taking the beam. The idea is when we start, for example, at the beginning of a run, it's going to be at one position. Then we're going to move it to different energies.
Uh-huh.
Once we've characterized the beam, we put it back in position and we let it run. The idea is each time, you know, when we run, we don't know how often, whether it'll be at the beginning of each run, whether it'll be once a month, we don't know how, with what frequency. But the idea is we characterize the flux once at multiple energies, and then we just let it run.
Huh.
It doesn't run while the experiment is running. Maybe there's designs actually in which it could, but the idea is you characterize the neutrino energy once and then...
It is for the precisely flux characterization that I had asked, because I remember it was quite difficult to get a pure muon or electron neutrino beam. The contamination was rather high, and it was really ending up contaminating the results, what you would be measuring in the far detector, especially when you have an on-axis far detector.
Yeah.
I was wondering how you solved that problem.
Right. No. So that's exactly right. So the way that we hope to solve it is by having, as you saw, a very fancy near detector. Mm. You know, it's going to be an off-axis beam. We're going to be, okay, yeah, sensitive to a broad range. So we're going to be measuring the broad range of energy in the far detector. We'll have them well characterized with this prism system. And as you saw, the near detector has, you know, an ECAL, it has a muon spectrometer, it has a gaseous component of liquid argon, liquid argon.
Mini atlas.
Yeah, exactly. It's basically a mini atlas. So We hope that we'll be able to understand neutrino-argon interactions well enough and characterize them across different energies, such that, because there's a lot of contamination, as you mentioned, a lot of them are going to be tau neutrinos and things like this. So.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ilyush, for your great presentation. My first question is that how far are we from hearing promising news from Dune about tau neutrino? And my second question is, where does University of Toronto stand in this collaboration?
So it's one of the things that actually tau neutrino is my favorite topics. This is one of the things that we're working on. It depends on, you know, we'll hopefully be able to detect some of them as soon as we turn on in 2029, at least from the atmosphere. So we're currently doing at University of Toronto studies to try and determine this. This world leading data set of tau neutrinos will probably be about 10 years in or so. So probably it'll take us some time to collect enough statistics to have this, you know, world, let's say, leading order sample of tau neutrinos, maybe 10 years. But early on, we think that we can hopefully detect ones, at least from the atmosphere. From the neutrino beam, it's a bit more difficult because the neutrino beam is 1 to 6 MeV. So it's, yeah, we're not right there. But from the atmosphere, hopefully, I don't have a strict answer for you because we're in the process of doing those studies. It also depends on whether there's an additional, if there's an additional neutrino exists. If an additional neutrino exists, we'll probably be able to detect it sooner through couplings with the tau neutrino. So that, for example, I have here. So if an additional neutrino exists, the coupling as a function of the tau neutrino, the Dune sensitivity is going to be in this blue line, which is going to be a world leading limit. And it's going to be, I think this is after a few years. I don't remember exactly. So yeah, the answer is it depends.
So thank you once again, Nicolina. And I'd like to give this on behalf of the organization committee an appreciation for your contribution.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
So our next speaker is Hasan Yılmaz from Bilkent University. He's going to talk on coherent wave transport in complex photonic media. Slaytların değişimini yapabilir miyiz?
Okay. Good morning. Thank you for the introduction. So I'm Hasan Yılmaz from Bilkent University, National Nanotechnology Research Center. And today I will talk about coherent wave transport through complex photonic media. Of course, in my case, it will be optical waves, but these results apply to any kind of waves, such as electron waves, matter waves, and acoustic waves, and so on. So this is the outline of my talk. First, I will introduce disordered structures as complex photonic media. It's one type of complex medium, but I will also describe what I mean by complex medium. Then Green's matrix formalism, to actually like characterize or understand wave propagation through such systems. And after that, I will introduce operators for disordered media. We can essentially customize the behavior of the disordered media using these operators and their eigenvectors. And then I will specifically show another example. Essentially, multimode optical fiber is also a complex system. And we also have some preliminary results on modifying light propagation through such systems. And then after that, I will conclude my talk. Okay, I think slides don't work. Okay, thanks. So first, let's think about a glass of like wine glass. So we all know that glass is transparent for visible light, so we can see through it. Typically, glass as the material, it's made of silicon dioxide, but the very same material will look very different. If we, for example, make it into a powder form, we cannot see through it. It will look white. The reason is because the refractive index of glass is around 1.5 or so, and there will be some air holes in between these microparticles. And for this reason, white light that is propagating through the system will scatter into random direction, and the information of the, like the image information will be completely scrambled. So this was one type of complex medium, but before introducing that complex medium, complex photonic system, there are also other types of complex systems. For example, photonic crystal. Photonic crystals, in photonic crystals, essentially, we periodically periodically modulate the refractive index in space, and such system will behave very different than a just normal homogeneous medium. For example, there will be band gaps similar to electronic band gap, which is due to constructive interference at a certain range, and it will be possible in all angles and all like all wavelengths like between this band gap. So here, essentially, the behavior of light on individual parts of the system, for example, one unit cell of the photonic, one particle of the photonic crystal behaves very differently than the complete total system, basically. We will see a completely new phenomenon because of this complex collective behavior of the photonic system. And another example is, for example, photonic quasi crystals. They can have, for instance, five-fold symmetry, six-fold symmetry, and so on. We can also similarly observe photonic band gaps in this type of structures. And the final example, which I also introduced in the beginning, is, for instance, photonic disordered medium. This is a zinc oxide powder, and it is the SEM image of this powder. So there are nanoparticles, which has approximately diameter around a few hundred nanometer. And light can also behave very differently in this type of structures. For example, you can observe mesoscopic effects such as Anderson localization and existence of open and closed channels, which I will introduce later. So in this talk, I am mainly interested in this type of photonic disordered systems, complex systems. So why do we study disordered systems? Because it's very it's very common in nature. For instance, a layer of white paint is essentially a disordered photonic medium or a biological tissue. The reason why we cannot see through our body, especially for red light, is light scattering. It's not absorption because the information is scrambled due to light scattering. That's why we cannot see inside our body using optical wavelengths. And finally, for instance, even snow is essentially a disordered photonic media because the water or ice and air is randomly distributed in space. For this reason, light will scatter in random directions. So in short, optical disorder is very common in nature. So let's introduce some parameters. So what I mean by disordered, optical disordered medium, I mean light in diffusive regime. So in order to make sure that the light is in diffusive regime, we need to understand some system parameters. For example, let's say if this is the side view of a disordered slab, it has the thickness of L, and let's assume for now the width is infinitely large. And the average transmittance, if we have an incident light from left, the average transmittance will be given by transport Mieffre path divided by thickness of the system. And the transport Mieffre path is the distance where light wave information is totally scrambled. It means after transport Mieffre path, if the system is thicker than the transport Mieffre path, you cannot see through this system at all anymore. It will completely become opaque. So we can actually classify disordered media, very same disordered media, at different classifications, which depends on the thickness essentially. If the scattering medium is thin, which means the thickness is less than the transport Mieffre path, it will be in the ballistic transport regime. And the total transmission will be approximately one. So there will be no back reflection, but the transmitted light will be scrambled a little bit. That's why there will be distortions. You can still see through ballistic media, but it will be a distorted image. And this kind of regime, there are very well-established methods such as optical coherence tomography and so on, where you can essentially characterize or image behind ballistic media. And the second regime is diffuse transport regime, where essentially the thickness is larger than the transport media path. So then this system is completely opaque and we cannot see through it anymore. And the last system is Anderson-Oculized regime. If the thickness is much larger than the transport regime, transport mean field path, then the average transmittance will be approximately zero. So which means all the light will reflect back. There will be no transmitted light in this regime. So in this talk, I am most interested in diffuse transport regime. Let's first understand what happens if we, for example, shine an incoherent light through a diffusive system. What we will see is just a blob of light in transmission, and this will give us almost no information. Let's say if you want to image something behind an opaque screen, the resolution of the image will be given by the thickness of the system, because you will use diffusive light waves to image, and that's the main reason why we don't see through our body. Right. For example, if we want to image something which is like 10 centimeter deep, the resolution is 10 centimeter. So it's hopeless. But if we send a coherent light, for example, laser light, which has a coherence length of several meters and so on, there will still be interference effect after transmission. And since the system is random, it will generate a pattern which looks like random and it's called speckle pattern. You can think this as of it's a random diffraction pattern. The reason why it is random is because your structure is random. For crystals, all of you probably know that if you send, for example, X-rays, you will see a periodic diffraction pattern depending on the symmetry of the crystal. But if, for example, if it is a totally amorphous material, you will see a completely random pattern, which is called a speckle pattern. So we can also observe this in optics. So it is actually the bright parts are constructive interference parts, and the dark parts are destructive interference parts. So even though this pattern looks random, it's not. It's deterministic, because the scattering process is still deterministic. It's an elastic scattering, so there has to be some information there, but just the information is very complicated. It's not easy to decode this information. So what we can do is essentially using spatial light modulators experimentally, we can reverse the scattering process. For instance, we can display the phase conjugate of this pattern, okay? And we can send the light, just propagate in backward direction, and we can correct this scattering process. But of course, we need to be able to measure the field and then synthesize it using this spatial light modulator. And here there's some one visualization of how we can shape the wavefronts using these spatial light modulators. We can display essentially a phase pattern, and then the reflected light, which is unshaped like a Gaussian beam, can be shaped into any shape you want. It's essentially holography, so you can synthesize any wavefront you want. So how do we, let's say, how can we formalize wave propagation in any arbitrary scattering system? Here, of course, I'm only talking about linear scattering. So there is no nonlinear effect or no absorption and so on for now. It's just linear scattering without loss. Let's say you have an arbitrary system which has the arbitrary dielectric constant or refractive index. So it can be random, or it can be a photonic crystal, anything. So you have incident fields and scattered fields, okay? So you can describe this system using the Green function of the system. Okay, we have here the Helmholtz equation, and the solution of this Helmholtz equation for a point source in space delta function will give us the Green function. So once we know the Green function of the system, we can really fully characterize the scattering process. This Green function essentially relates a point source at R prime to any point at R in this scattering system. Okay. If we discretize this Green function, we can call it Green's matrix, basically. We just discretize it in real space, and this will give us the Green matrix, which will relate the any point for the point source R prime to the point where we detect light, okay? So this is, when we have enough sampling, if we don't undersample during the discretization, we will have the full information of the system. So if you look at a part, very specific part of the Green function, we can also define a transmission matrix. Let's say that I want to map the incident fields from left to the output fields to the right, okay? Then let's say I'm choosing a certain orthonormal set of bases. It could be plane waves. I send a plane wave and then at a particular angle, and at the output, there will be light scattered at arbitrary many angles. Then I send the second plane wave, and then I have another set of wave vectors at the output, and third one and nth ones, and so on. So then I can construct the transmission matrix here, where each column here are different output patterns for a given plane wave input, okay? So this is in a plane wave basis, so I can go to any other basis I want, as long as it's a unitary transformation, okay? I can just multiply this transmission matrix with a transformation matrix from the right and left-hand side, then I can obtain it in any basis I want. For example, if I just obtain it in real space basis, let's say input surface and output surface, which relates the field at the input surface to the output surface, it will be a surface-to-surface Green function. So it's only one part of the Green function. But Green function is very general. You can also relate the fields inside the scattering system once you calculate it, not only outside, but now I'm looking at only a specific part of the Green function. So once we know this transmission matrix, we can relate the input field to the output field, because it's linear scattering. There are superpositions at the input, for example, can be also superposition at the output. So let's say if we know the full green matrix of the system, okay, not only the transmission matrix, but green matrix. It's very difficult to experimentally measure it, but we can measure up to a certain point, even inside. I will show one example. But let's assume we can calculate it numerically, right, for any arbitrary scattering system, and we can solve it exactly, actually, using very specific, like frequency domain calculations. I want to essentially send such a shape wavefront onto this system that I want to optimize a certain parameter. It can be anything. For example, it can be total transmission, certain correlation functions, or energy deposition at a certain depth, and so on. I just want my scattering system to behave whatever I want. This behavior, there's a figure of merit of this behavior. How good it is given by a certain parameter, which is alpha I, okay? So I can be anything. For example, if I is one, it is total transmission. If it is two, it is, total reflection. If it is three, it is like energy deposition to a certain depth. For example, if you want to focus light inside a biological tissue for some application, you may need to optimize this parameter. It's very general. We want to optimize this parameter by wavefront shaping using a special light modulator. Then we will define an operator, which is Q, which will depend on the Green matrix that we know already. Okay, it will be as a function of Green matrix, this operator, and I want to optimize it for a certain parameter I. Defining this Q is not very trivial, but there are certain methods. For example, there are some systematic methods, which is like Lagrangian-based method. You can put your constraints and also parameter that you want to optimize, and then you can derive your eigenvalue relationship or generalized eigenvalue. You can end up with a nonlinear optimization problem, but it's very general. For example, one example is if this is a simple, operator where we can end up with a linear operator, which is a very simple operator, then we can just find the eigenvectors of this operator, which will maximize or minimize this alpha parameter that we want to maximize. Okay, so this is the approach. So I will show some examples of how we do it essentially. So one very well-known example is total transmission. So if T is our transmission matrix, T dagger T, where dagger is essentially a conjugate transpose of this matrix, this operator will optimize the total transmittance through the system. So if we calculate the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of this operator, since this is a semi-definite positive matrix, its eigenvalues are non-negative real numbers, okay? and their eigenvalues have a meaning. They are total transmission. So total transmission can only be positive or zero, right? There's no other option. So it's very well known that if it's a random system without loss, their eigenvalue distribution, if we make a histogram of these eigenvalues, we'll have a bimodal distribution. Okay, one means total transmission is one, zero means it is zero. So everything is reflected because there's no absorption. So in this system, bimodal distribution is really analytically also very well known with this expression. And these are called open channels and these are called closed channels. And it's not very trivial because imagine that you have a like scattering system. It can be a wall, very thick wall. If you can really waveform shape your laser beam in such a way that it's an open channel, everything will be transmitted. There will be no reflection, independent of the thickness of the wall. So, and essentially, we did some measurements and also some simulations on these open channels in a geometry where our system width is very large, almost infinitely large, and thickness is large enough that it's in a diffusive regime. So most of the light is reflecting back. Here you see the type of samples we work on experimentally. And here you see the simulation geometry. Simulations are 2D, because this is a very big system. It's near impossible to simulate the 3D system now, but soon it will be possible, essentially. We are almost there. So this is the site view of the scattering system. So if I send an arbitrary wavefront, most of the wavefront will be reflected, as you see. The energy is on the left-hand side, and there's almost nothing on the right because it's a very thick scattering medium. Okay. So, for example, if I shine my laser beam on this screen, we see the laser beam because most of it is reflecting. Very little amount is transmitting because this is an opaque screen. It's very similar. So, but if I send an open channel, which is the eigenstate of T dagger T, what we see is that everything is transmitting. All the total energy is transmitting to the other side. But more surprisingly, this is already known for a few decades. But what was surprising in our case, it was also localized. And even though we didn't dictate it to be localized in any position, it was just naturally localized. And when we look at the second eigenstate, it was localized somewhere else. And third one, somewhere else, and so on. They were all localized. And then even more surprisingly, when we look at their cross-section, the wavefront cross-section at the input at the output, in log scale, we see it's linearly decaying, which means it's an exponential localized function. So exponential localization is typically expected from Anderson localizing systems, but not diffusive systems. So it was a very big surprise for us. The third surprise was when we, for example, quantitatively find out the width of this beam using this participation number, which is essentially gives us the variance of this function along this transverse direction. So effectively beam size. What we see is the beam size at the output and at the input are essentially equal. This was also a surprise because imagine that you have a beam, laser beam, in a very foggy day, what will happen is it will diffuse laterally, right? It will spread. But if it's an eigenstate, it doesn't spread. It goes straight as if there is no diffusion. This was also a surprise for us. So, and even a fourth surprise was even the closed channels. Here you see the normalized width of this beam, localized beam, versus the transmission eigenvalue. So these are open channels. These are closed channels. Even the closed channels are localized. Of course, when I say closed channel, it's not totally closed channel. There's still like 10 to the minus 3 transmittance. So at the input, which are shown by blue dots, and the output is the red crosses. So none of them are spreading, and all of them are localized. This was a surprise for us. So as you know, like for random input or diffuse beam, we just expect a lateral diffusion, as you see here. So which will, for example, one of the consequences of this is in a foggy day, if you drive, and if there's a car coming from the other direction and it is too far, you don't even know whether it's a car or motorcycle because these two headlights will combine due to this lateral spreading diffusion. But if this car somehow can couple into the open channels in a foggy day, there would be no lateral spreading and the light will just go completely straight as if there was no diffusion. But in practice, it's very difficult because fog is a very dynamic system. So its scattering matrix, green matrix, is changing constantly. Okay. So as I show you, like there will be lateral spread if you focus on a diffusive system, but not wavefront shape to an open channel. So another way of looking at this effect is looking at this surface-to-surface green matrix, okay, or it is the real space transmission matrix. That's the other way to define it. So what we will see is actually at each column we will see a different output that shifted to a different center. So then if we zoom in around the diagonal here, we will see that this is not really a diagonal matrix, but there are still some random elements at off diagonal. But after, for example, L distance from the diagonal element, all the elements will vanish almost to zero. So this is a random matrix, but this is a banded random matrix. And it's very well known in the literature in random matrix theory. And it's known that their eigenstates are localized. So what we observed was essentially a localization of eigenstates of a banded random matrix. But there was another, this banded structure of the transmission matrix has some interesting consequences, which has a lot of applications. One application is essentially using optical memory effect. You can image through scattering layers. Let me show you how you can do it. For example, if this is the banded transmission matrix in real space, its Fourier transform will give us the angle-to-angle transmission matrix. Okay, transmission matrix in the angular spectrum, which means it gives, let's say I send a plane wave at a particular angle. At the output, it gives me at which angles, how much light is scattered, okay? So if I zoom in, what I see that there are some correlations along the diagonal in the angular domain. These are called memory effect. It means if I, for example, crop some part of this transmission matrix and shift it along the diagonal, the matrix will not change so much. It's almost the same. So you can essentially exploit this property. One consequence of this is, let's say, if you have a plane wave input, at the output you have in far field of the output, you will have a speckle pattern. If you tilt your beam slightly, your output pattern in far field will be shifted, okay? Because tilt in real space is a shift in Fourier space. So you can essentially scan your speckle pattern on the other side. And there is, of course, you cannot scan it infinitely. Its scan range will be given by the thickness. So as the sample becomes thicker and thicker, this width of this correlation function will get smaller and smaller. Okay, so you can only scan a shorter and shorter range as sample gets thicker, which makes sense. When the sample gets thicker, the bandwidth of the real space transmission matrix will be larger, and what is large in real space will be small in Fourier space. So one example of this is essentially, you can, let's say you want to image some fluorescent nanoparticles behind the scattering medium. First, with wavefront shaping, you can focus on these nanoparticles, okay? Like similar to what I explained in the beginning, you can undo this scattering using a spatial light modulator. Then you can scan this focus using the memory effect and image this fluorescent nanoparticles. And you can do non-invasive imaging. For example, you don't even have to focus. You can just scan the speckle pattern behind an opaque layer, and you don't even have to put a detector behind the opaque layer. You can put your detector in the reflection geometry, so you can only detect the fluorescence from this fluorescent sample, and non-invasively you can recover the image by using some reconstruction algorithms. For example, this is the real image, this is the reconstructed image. So this memory effect is really useful, but the problem is its scan range is limited. Therefore, you cannot image very large objects because you cannot scan along the size of the object. So therefore, we think that can we essentially manipulate the optical memory effect? That was the idea. Like this is essentially like a traditional memory effect where the scan range is limited and also the tilt angle is well defined. For example, if I am tilting my input wavefront here like counterclockwise, and my also the transmitted wavefront will tilt counterclockwise in the same direction with the same amount, okay? So the idea is, can we manipulate this? For example, I just encode such a wavefront here on the spatial light modulator. It was plane wave here. This is something else. That when I'm tilting it along this x-axis, the output will tilt along y-axis at arbitrary ranges. Can we do that by wavefront shaping? So it's essentially, can we customize the correlations, angular correlations using wavefront shaping? It should be possible, but how do we, I mean, which parameter we have to optimize? That's the question. So first, let's define the angular correlation coefficient. That's the parameter we want to maximize, the correlation coefficient. And the definition of this correlation coefficient is given by this expression. This is the input wavefront, Vn, okay, for different n's. Let's say we will have a set of different input wavefronts. This is the transmission matrix T, and these are some sort of rotation operators on the transmission matrix at the input and at the output, okay? So we want to apply such transformation on the matrix that, for example, when I tilt the matrix, the untilted, if I look at the inner product between the tilted matrix and the untilted matrix, I will still have some sort of correlation coefficient, which is non-zero. That's the idea, okay? I want to be able to choose this theta in and theta out arbitrarily. And the denominator is just a normalization such that this correlation coefficient can be only zero or one, nothing else. Okay, so we started with this operator. It looks like it came out of the sky, but it's not. There is some procedure how we choose our operator. The idea is essentially, let's say this is our tilted matrix at the input and at the output, and I want to be able to tilt it in random, arbitrary directions, okay? And this part is essentially the inverse of the matrix, okay? And this is a very general inverse. It's a, Roger, actually, it's a Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse, where you can also invert the rectangular matrices, not only square matrices, but also rectangular matrices. If, for example, your T is square, this will turn out to be just a regular matrix inversion. But here, another important detail is, another way to think about this operator is the following. Here, essentially, let's don't take this term into account first, only focus on this part, okay? So this operator is essentially numerator of the parameter that I was trying to optimize, okay? This parameter, okay? It's optimizing the numerator. It's literally this, if you see this one, it's, if we find the extremal values of this, let's say operator, we just need to find the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of this operator, okay? So it was, and this part is essentially almost like the denominator, because it's the inverse of the matrix, inverse of this multiplication. So this part is making sure that we are trying not only increasing the total transmission, but we are increasing the similarity between shifted and unshifted wavefronts at the output, okay? If we don't have this regularizing term, we may end up only coupling into open channels, but not really the correlated wavefronts. Okay, so as I said, if it's a square matrix, we will end up only with this operator, and eigenvectors of this operator will be Q, V, N, and let's say Vn's are eigenvectors, Q is the operator, alpha N are the eigenvalues. If we write down this operator, what we will see that essentially by definition, Cn will be one, the correlations will be perfect, okay? So which means if we use this operator for a square matrix, which means number of inputs and outputs are the same, so number of input modes and output modes are the same, this operator will, by definition, give us perfect correlation for any input-output angle pairs that we choose. So it has to work. So this is the experimental setup where essentially we shine a monochromatic laser beam on the spatial light modulator, and then the reflected beam is incident on the sample surface, and we have a reference beam to measure the field holographically at the output. And we can measure the transmission matrix in this setup, okay, using this spatial light modulator. So then after measuring the transmission matrix, we can define the operator and find the eigenstates of the operator, and we can display the eigenstates on the spatial light modulator. We can really experimentally realize these eigenstates and scan them to measure the correlation function for different angles. For example, here I want to show one example. Our input is tilted in -7.8 degrees and output is 7.1 degrees. Completely different directions, different amount. And you see that the patterns are very similar, essentially. This one is tilted, as you see. The patterns are very similar. You can see the correlation. So these are the amplitude and these are the phases of the patterns. And the amplitude correlation is 82%, phase correlation is 83%. Why not 100%, like I said? Because the matrix was rectangular. We have more output than input, so we use more Penrose pseudo-inversion. So this is another example. We tilt in a vertical direction at the input, and at the output, we tilt in a horizontal direction, as you see, and we still see a very high correlation, similarity between wavefronts. Both amplitude and phase. So if we, for example, measure two-dimensional correlation function, so input to output, we can see that this is just a regular memory effect, which is in the diagonal for an arbitrary wavefront. We see another memory effect at an arbitrary input-output like pair. So this may enable, for example, in principle, you can essentially optimize along this diagonal and increase the memory effect to increase the scan range for imaging, which is based on memory effect applications. And this is the input phase. You see that input phase on the SLM is very random. So the correlations are not at the input. It's really, we are really coupling into highly correlated channels through the scattering system. It's nothing to do with input, basically. Okay, this was one example of optimization using operators, which are based on the Green matrix. The second example is actually we can measure some part of the Green matrix also inside the scattering system. But of course, this is for now only possible in two-dimensional systems, because then we can use the third dimension to probe the field inside the complex photonic system. Here you see a disordered waveguide. And it has closed boundaries by these photonic crystal boundaries. Okay, so it's like a waveguide with some disorder, which are made by holes which are randomly distributed inside. And we can essentially, by interfering a plane wave with this out of plane scattered light from the sample, we can measure the field inside for any arbitrary input wavefront. Okay. So we have a taper here in order to control many modes, because when we are coupling from air to silicon, we cannot couple to high order modes, but instead we can couple low order modes for a very wide waveguide and then taper it down to control all the modes of the system. Okay, there are like 56 modes propagating in this waveguide. And then once we have the disorder, all modes will couple to each other. So it will be essentially like a two-dimensional diffusive system. So our goal is now essentially define such a matrix that the input field is mapped to the field inside these regions, R1, R2, R3, R4, okay? So this matrix is called deposition matrix, and it's a part of the Green matrix, okay? It's part of the Green matrix. And here En is essentially the input field. Sorry, En is the measured field inside. Zd is the depth that we choose. Y is the cross-sectional position, okay? And this XM is only like a mode decomposition, so we can decompose the real space field to the modes of the waveguide, okay? And this is just a normalization constant. So this Z deposition matrix is essentially mapping the inputs N to the outputs M, okay? And this En is the field at the region we choose for the input N, okay, from the SLM. So what we do then is we define a deposition operator, which is Z dagger Z at any position, and then we find the eigenstates of this operator. The idea is we want to deposit energy to a chosen depth in a diffusive system, okay? So this is like a simple geometry of the setup. So we are coupling light, and then we are measuring the output out of plane scattering. This is a detailed setup. So we are essentially interferometrically measuring the field inside, and then we can recover both amplitude and phase. Okay, by this at any position for any given input. So then when we do that, we can essentially maximize the intensity at any depth, for example, here R1, R2, or minimize it. How do we minimize? We just choose the minimum eigenvalues of the operator. Okay, and this is the random input. As you see, if you send a diffuse random input, it will almost linearly decay. If we couple into this operator, we will enhance or we will suppress. So, and we can even, using random matrix theory, we can even estimate how much we can enhance or suppress at different depths. So these are the statistical distributions. As you see at the end, we will recover the bimodal distribution. Okay, if because there is no, almost there's no absorption, only little bit out of plane scattering loss, which is very minor. And inside what we see that the maximum eigenvalue is even larger than maximum eigenvalue at the output, which means we can enhance the energy inside even more compared to the transmitted energy. So energy can accumulate inside the scattering system. Surprisingly, it's always 2/3 of the total thickness of the system, which is universal, independent of the different thicknesses. So for example, if I want to deposit energy into a scattering system, the maximum energy that I can deposit it will be on always 2/3 of the system thickness. Okay. And the last part, probably I don't have enough time, but I can maybe quickly pass. We can also apply these concepts to multimode fibers, and multimode fibers has a lot of applications in like intercontinental communication, short haul communication, fiber lasers, biomedical imaging, and so on. So if you have so this is a step index fiber that we are working on, and if the core size is large enough, it can support a lot of modes actually, and we can address all these modes individually using a spatial light modulator. So speckle can also form through these fibers because there will be a phase accumulation between different fiber modes because they all have different propagation constants and which will randomize the phases between them. So we will end up with a speckled pattern. Okay, so we can essentially we numerically calculate transmission matrices of these fibers in mode spaces, of course, the identity matrix, but in real space spaces it looks rather complicated. And for example, when I compare it to disordered layer, it looks like a complicated matrix, not a nice banded matrix. So which means it doesn't have any memory effect. Okay. And then what we can do is we define another operator. I'm passing these details. Here, actually, the only difference is we are summing over many operators to optimize the memory effect at arbitrary angles simultaneously. So it will be a continuous correlation function. Okay. So I'm just passing those. So here one example, this is without optimization. So the correlation function decays very fast. With the optimization, it will be much wider actually. And this is another mode. So there are many examples. So these are numerical results for now, but we also have now experimental results. So we are about to also complete that part. So in conclusion, operator-based wavefront shaping approach is powerful to customize complex photonic media. So we discovered that optimizing total transmission also modifies spatial structure of waves. So with this approach, we not only do some wavefront control, but we can also discover new type of physics in these complex systems because we can essentially address different eigenstates of the system. And actually there are even studies to relate scattering matrix or transmission matrix to Hamiltonian of the system. Which will even give more, deeper physics of these complex systems. And we demonstrate that the memory effect can be modified using the eigenvectors of the memory operator through disordered media and also multimode fiber. Why it's important for multimode fiber? Because if you want to make a very thin endoscope through a scattering tissue such as brain, multimode fiber is the best because it will have a thickness in the order of few hundred micron. And it's much thinner than like camera-based endoscopes or fiber bundle-based endoscopes. If you can really control wave propagation, you can also detect images or send images through these multimode fibers. That's why it's very important. And encoding correlations will enable also imaging using memory effect through this kind of fibers. So also energy can be deposited deep inside disordered media with the energy deposition operators eigenvectors. So finally, I would like to introduce the current group members and my collaborators. And we also have now open positions for postdocs, PhD students, and master students. If you are interested, please contact me so we can discuss in detail. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this interesting talk. Before I go for the questions, you mentioned when you introduced the fiber part in the very last.
Yes.
You mentioned that those multimodes would be available depending on the size of the fiber.
Yes.
You mean
the core size.
Yeah, the core size, of course. And does it fit, for example, with standard conventional fibers all around used for communication? Or you're referring to something different?
These fibers are actually, you can purchase them. They are commercially available, even from Tor Labs, which is, for example, you can go up to core sizes of several hundred micrometers.
Mm-hmm.
We have, for example, a 200 micrometer one in the lab, which supports 10,000 of modes, which means you can transport images with 10,000 of pixels.
Okay. So any questions, comments on Zoom first? Seems no. In room?
On the experimental front, the spatial light modulators are great, but they're also quite slow. I'm wondering, has anybody considered using the transmitted light, taking it and nonlinearly converting it?
Yes.
And then using it as another source to impose a wavefront on the incoming beam, new beam from the laser, as an optical, nonlinear optical modulator. Does this make sense? Has anybody explored this?
Yes, that's a very good question. Actually, Changwan Yang's group in Caltech, they did it in 2010. They use optical phase conjugation using a nonlinear material at the end of the fiber. They did it through a scattering medium, but you can also do it through a fiber. Then you can phase conjugate the light beam, and but you have to send it back from the end side to the front side. Then they recover the undistorted beam. But the issue with this is actually the nonlinear conversion efficiency is in the order of 5%. So you are losing 95% of your light beam. But it's possible indeed, and it's much faster. It's instantaneous. But alternatively, people show that you can digitally phase conjugate your field. So you don't have to measure the total transmission matrix. In order to focus, you can essentially measure the field profile and digitally resynthesize it only once, not many times, as you measure in the transmission matrix, and send it back. So yes, it's possible to nonlinearly modulate the wavefront in such a way that you phase conjugate the field. It's basically a phase conjugate mirror, either a nonlinear phase conjugate mirror or digital phase conjugate mirror. But there are also now very fast modulators, which we also have one in our lab, digital micromirror-based modulators, which can go up to 50 kilohertz modulation speeds. They are not perfect, but they are much better than the spatial light modulators, which are in the order of 100 hertz or so, usually.
If I may have a follow-up question or a second idea, in all these applications, I think our people are using a single wavelength. How about if you had multiple wavelengths separated from each other, so the scattering matrix is different, but the information is coming from the same scatterer, so this brings in constraints. Has anybody explored using this idea to reduce the information that you have to get?
Yes. Yes, indeed, quite a few groups did that, spatial-temporal control through scattering medium, such as Sylvain Gigant's group in Paris. You can measure spatial-temporal transmission matrix. You can either measure it in the frequency space, then take Fourier transform and go to time domain, or in time domain with time result interference measurements. It's possible. In fact, we are currently also collaborating with his group to study time-gated transmission matrices and their eigenvectors and their localization for different delay types. The idea is essentially you have a reference beam, which is a pulse, ideally fully transform limited pulse, also a nice Gaussian beam, and you have your spatial temporal speckled pattern at the output. And then what you can do is essentially you can overlap this pulse, reference pulse, with your transmitted pulse at a certain delay time. And by using phase shift interferometry, for any time delays, you can essentially recover the phase holographically. But it's a very long measurement because you have to measure the transmission matrix for many different delay types. Or alternatively, you can have a tunable laser and measure the transmission matrix at many different frequencies and take a Fourier transform. But the phase has to be very stable during this measurement. And not only phase difference between the spatial modes, but also in different frequencies or different time domains. So it's a difficult measurement, but possible. People are exploring this. It has a lot of applications also in multiphoton microscopy, because if you want to focus through a biological tissue, and if you want to do, let's say, three photon absorption imaging, it's better that you have a control not only in space, but also in time. You also want to focus in time. So you need to be able to control pulses. But it's a very active field, actually. It started like 5 years ago or so on. It's still continuing, and there's still a lot of things to do.
One last question or comment. We still have time. Benny? Seems not to be the case. So on behalf of the organization committee, I would like to give this to you. Appreciation of your contribution. Thank you. We now have a break of almost half an hour. So we will reconvene around 12:15 for the second part of this morning's session.